has voted to proceed the legislation before us in order to preserve maximum flexibility for productive conversation to continue between the White House and our Democratic colleagues.
We are willing to continue discussions on those proposals with the leader, the president, the speaker of the House, and the leader of the House.
So you're saying there's a chance. The partial government shutdown, which is less than 6 hours away, 5 hours, 20 minutes away, would possibly be avoided if they continue negotiating and they come with some solution that would then have to pass the Senate and then bounce back to the House, get past there and head to the president's desk. Why do we call it a partial government shutdown? It's because a lot of the spending bills have already been passed. If you look at this pie chart, 75% have already been funded. We're talking about 25% here, not yet enacted. It's still a lot of people, potentially, that wouldn't get paid for some period of time, depending on how long it goes. As we talked about yesterday, they got their checks this week. There's a holiday coming up, so there's some buffer room there, but it's still very serious. Let's bring in our panel. Start there. Tom Rogan, commentary writer for The Washington Examiner. Molly Hemingway, senior editor at The Federalist. And David Cantonese, senior politics writer for U.S. News and World Report. Okay, David, so, you know, they left this vote open today because the Republicans didn't have the votes.
Right.
And then they make a deal, and now they're talking. And we just don't know where that's going to go.
Something's going to have to give if they can get this done in 4 hours. Either they can maneuver the language so it's for border security, but maybe not for exactly a wall. Maybe they throw a little money and then Trump can claim victory. But look, I think the Democrats hold the cards here. I thought it was very telling that earlier in the day when the vice president went up there with Jared Kushner and Mick Mulvaney that the meeting was with Schumer. It is not with McConnell. It's about getting Democrats on board. Now, I saw in the last procedural vote, Doug Jones, the senator from Alabama, voted to move forward. So maybe there's some opportunity to get Democratic votes, but tough to get to 60.
Joe Manchin voted against it from West Virginia. Molly, this is what Chuck Schumer kept on referring to today numerous times talking to reporters. This is the Oval Office meeting back on December 11th.
You know what I'll say? Yes. If we don't get what we want, one way or the other, whether it's through you, through a military, through anything you want to call, I will shut down the government.
Okay,
absolutely.
Fair enough.
And I am proud, and I'll
tell
you what,
I
am proud to shut down the government for border security, Chuck, because the people of this country don't want criminals and people that have lots of problems and drugs pouring into our country. So I will take the mantle. I will be the one to shut it down. I'm not going to blame you for it. The last time you shut it down, it didn't work. I will take the mantle
Good.
Of shutting down. And I'm going to shut it down for border
security.
But we
believe you.
So fast forward 10 days, and this is the Trump today, the Democrats, the president today, the Democrats now own the shutdown, saying the bill had passed the House and was now in the Senate.
And what I think is really interesting is we have not solved a lot of our immigration problems because the incentive structure hasn't been there. Both Democrats and Republicans have benefited by being able to use the issue without actually solving it. What makes this very interesting is Donald Trump has no incentive to do anything other than wait for a bill that provides money for the border fence. I mean, he can wait as long as he wants, partly because it's we've got a government that's 75% funded, but also because if he does not provide this, it is a very serious problem for him and his electoral future. And he has no incentive to accept anything other than meaningful border wall funding. And so I think when he looks at the shutdown, he views it as something where he gets to take credit for caring enough about border security to go to this point. But Democrats actually, like, they might just be playing into his hands by going into it if they're not willing to play. And they've already voted for border security. They've already voted for border fences. There should not be anything that
different. Well, and that's symbolic, and that's where the opposition is. That's where I think the horse trading has to occur. Border security, that's not a wall. I mean, the president even changed the language on this. He's talking about slaps and
right.
not a wall.
And he tweeted out this picture of what the potential new wall would look like, steel slap barrier, Tom.
Yes, look, I think David is correct that
if we get to a shutdown, there will be fudging of language, some money. But to Molly's point, I think that is the critical component here. I think President Trump, to a degree, wants the shutdown because he feels, especially in the context of the Mattis, the negative coverage there, he wants to show, actually, I'm the hard charging, I'm the candidate Trump. And that will matter going into that presidential election year, because whether you know it or not, or whether we know it or not, a lot of Americans did vote for him then. I also think the president's benefit is that Democrats being seen to oppose border security from a hard left line by a lot of American perception will be negative for their candidate. So this may flip in his favor later on.
Yeah, we'll monitor it throughout the night. You'll see all the developments here on Fox News Channel. You mentioned Secretary Mattis stepping down, resignation letter yesterday that was, you know, frankly, there were a lot of things in that letter. If you read it again and again and again, he does not say anything positive about President Trump, and he's very pointed about leaving because of ideological differences, and specifically about Syrian troop withdrawals and then Afghanistan troop withdrawals. Molly.
And I think one of the things that was interesting that came out about this was that we learned 8 months ago Donald Trump gave Mattis 6 months to get out of Syria. And not only did he not come up with a plan to get out of Syria, it seems like he took that time as an opportunity to ramp up efforts in Syria. It is fine that General Mattis has different foreign policy views than President Trump, but the American people elected President Trump to be the commander-in-chief, and he has every right to have very good defense secretary and other people who actually understand that they need to provide him with good options. And so if he'd never had any intention of upholding these policies, he probably shouldn't have taken the job, or he should have resigned at the point when he realized that there was a conflict.
However, critics would say, David, that how it happened, the process of, you know, the story leaking that this was starting to happen and then the president tweeting it out and the allies and the lawmakers and the oversight and the Pentagon were really in the dark.
Yes, and I think, you know, the story that's been told is that Mattis went over there one last time to try to change the president's mind on Syria, but then had his resignation letter written, submit it. I mean, we were talking in the green room before, though. I mean, who gets better press in Washington than General Mattis? The guy, I mean, is getting accolades from Democrats, from liberals. So I think there is some of this piling on.
And
President
by the way,
Trump.
Some of them said that they were really opposed to having troops on the ground in Syria.
For sure.
And now they are suddenly really behind that effort.
Because it's an anti-Trump thing. So I think there is something that I would just say the broader question, though, who replaces Mattis is going to be a huge question in 2019. The president's going to have four cabinet confirmation hearings, UN ambassador, defense, attorney general, and interior.
All
coming in 2019.
And he'll probably also have Mueller. Yeah. To deal with yeah.
right.
in the beginning of 2019 as well.
I do think, interestingly, though, from the sort of looking at the president's foreign policy, he has obviously the right to have the defense secretary he wants. You know, whatever we think about the Syria decision, I don't necessarily buy into this argument, though, that Mattis's departure means the real America first. Because if you actually look at the cabinet balance, Bolton, Pompeo, very tough on Iran. The idea of Tom Cotton being talked about as the next Secretary of Defense, very tough on Iran. Mattis, even though the Obama administration pushed him out for being too hawkish on Iran, was seen as the interlocutor, sort of. So we'll see. We will.